they have to record, so I have to move the. I will start here and go to the very long blackboard. But it seems the camera is not ready for this part. For the recording, do you hear me? Sorry, again, for the recording, can you hear me? Hypothetische Tiere? Ancora, mi potete sentire fuori per registrare, per la registrazione? Yeah, but the camera is not okay. I cannot hear. But the camera is not okay. I will start here. You have.
You can hear it.
Because if I start now, the camera is not okay. Somebody has to follow,
yeah.
Because I use all the blackboard, no?
Yeah, I know.
Ah.
Okay.
Who is moving the camera? You?
Yeah, me.
Yeah, so you should, not on me, but on the blackboard,
yeah.
Where are you writing?
On the last finger you wrote.
On yes, on this
yeah.
part.
Yeah.
If I'm walking, that's no problem. I walk,
follow you.
But you keep the blackboard, okay?
Yeah,
with the blackboard.
On the last finger you wrote.
Yes,
on.
Because
yeah.
I use all the blackboard, and so...
Yeah, there's no problem. Okay.
Andrea, mi senti? Okay.
So now we can hear you. No, no.
20 seconds and then...
Yeah, but I see you have to... I start here, no?
I will see the camera moving.
Yes.
So you can start.
Yes. Okay, so we start. Still very basic stuff, okay? The whole course is very basic stuff, except maybe the last lecture. So continuous functions. It's a basic language of mathematics, general topology, continuous functions. So what is the definition? Definition. So X and Y are topological spaces. And then a function or a map, a function, that's the same, map and function. F from x to y is continuous. If for each open set, so I use the notion of the book, of course, V in Y, the pre-image F minus 1, the pre-image F minus 1 of V is open in X. So that's a very short definition. It's one sentence, okay? So this means that pre-images of open sets are open. So that's a nice picture. Pre-images of open sets are open. Pre-images of open sets are open. That's even shorter, no? Pre-image of open sets are open. This is a global definition of continuity, if you want. I call this a global definition of continuity. Continuity, the global definition of continuity. Pre-image of open sets are open. And we can restrict to, if you have a basis, then or a remark, or a lemma, if you want, lemma. But I will not prove. This is set theory again. Sorry? No. So lemma, if B is a basis, let B be a basis well, how is it called? B. It doesn't matter, but I want to use the notion of the book. Of a given basis, there's no name. Let B be a basis for the topology of Y. Then F is continuous. So F is continuous if and only if F minus 1, pre-images of basis elements. We don't have to check all open sets. We can restrict to basis elements. F minus 1 of B is open for each B in the basis. So we can check only for basis elements. So this is how to pass from a basis to topology. Arbitrary unions. The pre-image of a union is the union of the pre-images. So if all the pre-images are open, then the union remains. So this is okay immediately. But it's useful. Let B be a basis. F is continuous. If and if. And the same, this is the first part. And the second part is the same for subbasis, okay? Same for a subbasis. So I write it this way. The same for a subbasis, S. So we do have to check for all open sets. Then for a basis element, it's sufficient. And then even for a subbasis. The same for a subbasis. S of Y. So you remember how to pass from a basis to a subbasis? You take finite intersections. So the pre-image of an intersection is the intersection of the pre-images. Again, if the pre-images are open, then the intersection, finite intersection, will remain open. Finite intersections of open sets are open. Okay, so this is useful, okay? Topology, basis, subbasis. And now we have the local definition, and that's from analysis, the epsilon delta. Except that we don't have metric spaces. We will discuss also metric spaces. But so here's a definition. Another definition. F from x to y, so the same f from x to y, is continuous continuous. In a point now. Continuous in a point. X and X, if for each neighborhood V, if for each neighborhood, so I abbreviate neighborhood, okay, neighborhood as usual, for each neighborhood V of f of x, given a neighborhood V of f of x, there is a neighborhood, an open set containing. There is a neighborhood U of x such that f of u is contained in V. So this is the epsilon delta, if you want, from analysis, right? If you have metric spaces, then this neighborhood will be epsilon ball, for example, and this will be delta, okay? So given epsilon, there's delta such that, and so on and so on. So this is obviously a local, okay? Local definition of continuity. So this is a local definition. Local definition of continuity in each point. So there are local properties and global properties, okay? This is global, this is local. And then the proposition, of course, is f from x is continuous, from x to y, this is always the same, is continuous, if and only if, is continuous, if and only if. F is continuous in every point, in each point, f is continuous. In each point, in every point, x and x. So this is more general. A function may be continuous in some points and in some points not continuous. Then it's not continuous globally, okay? But locally it may be continuous in some points, in other points not. If it is continuous globally, then it's continuous in all points. This is equivalent, okay? So the proof is very easy. So we have two directions. Well, every now and then I prove something, okay? These are all very easy. So I didn't prove before this, but let's write. So which direction? If it's this direction, let's see this direction. So this means f is continuous. So we have to, now I write, let x be in x. We have to prove x is continuous in the point x, no? So let x, and what do we need? A neighborhood. And how is it called? V, a neighborhood. Let x be an x, and let v be a neighborhood of f of x. So I use the definition of local. Then, so I take u as a preimage, okay, f minus 1. Of V is open. So it's open because F is continuous. Since F is continuous, no? So U is the neighborhood of X, okay? Then is open and the neighborhood, of course, the neighborhood of X. Such that. So f of u such that f of u, which is f of f minus 1 of v. So this is not equal to v, but it's certainly contained in v. So this implies f is continuous in x. So this is very easy. And let's see also the other. Let's see also the other direction. F is continuous in X. So now F is continuous in every point. And so we have to prove that pre-images of open sets are open, okay? So what? So we take an open set in Y. So let V be open in Y. And we have to prove that the pre-image, its pre-image is open in X. So we take a point in the pre-image. So let V open in Y and X a point in F minus 1 of V. So F of X is in V. That means V is the neighborhood of F of X, no? V is the neighborhood of F of X. But F is continuous in X, no? It's continuous in every point, okay? So F continues in this point. What does it say? Implies that there's a neighborhood. We apply the definition. Neighborhood U, what's it called? U, UX. Depends on this. This is a small x, okay? That's the point. A neighborhood of X such that F of UX is contained in V. And then we are done because F minus 1 of V, what is it?
Union of?
Sorry?
Union.
Yes. Oh, you have microphone all, or how does it work? Yes, you should be able to talk, right? You can ask, you can interrupt. But I was surprised because I thought it comes from. So you have a microphone? Where is it? That comes from. So you can interrupt, ask, because sometimes I change symbols. I use the wrong symbol and so on. That happens. So F minus 1, what did you say? That's a union of UX, where X is in F minus 1 of V, no? And here it's two directions, no? Each UX, F of UX is contained in V, and also the other inclusion. We get all points in F minus 1 of V. We have all points, okay? We have all points. So it's equal. And so this means it's open, no? It's open. Because it's a union, arbitrary union of open sets. Okay? So this is the proof. Example. And we will see very strange examples. In analysis, you see the nice examples. And in general topology, you see strange examples, but more interesting sometimes. In analysis, sometimes it's boring, no? The standard topologies, okay? But here, we don't have standard topologies, and then we have interesting, we will see very interesting examples. Not this week, but we start. Yeah, one we saw, RL. So what is this RL? This is L. So this is the reals. I don't know if I introduce this. The reals with the lower limit topology. With the lower limit topology. So this is an L, lower limit topology. This is a stupid example, but then the identity map, which I always write, then the identity map. The identity map. Identity from R to, from RL to R first. RL to R is continuous. Why? Pre-image of open set is the same set here, but this topology is finer than this, so it is open also in the other. It's continuous since RL is, the topology of RL is finer than, I will not write, it's continuous, okay? Because it's finer, this is the finer topology, okay? This is the finer topology and this is the coarser topology, okay? It's continuous, but if you go in the other direction, identity in the other direction from R to RL, what about this? It's not continuous. Since the topology of RL is strictly finer than the topology, okay? Strictly, here we need strictly. Since the topology of RL is strictly finer. There are more open sets here. So some open sets are not open here. Take pre-image, we get something which is not open. It's strictly finer than the standard topology. So this is an example which shows that if we have a bijective map, which is continuous, then the inverse map, we have a bijective map, which is continuous, then the inverse map need not be continuous, okay? This is an example. That's an important point in topology. And we will see again RL today. This is one of the main examples of the book, by the way, okay? This is the first one. So a small proposition. We see it again today. So I go to the other, I restart on the other side. This is the longest blackboard in Trieste. And I will start on the left and then I always go. Okay, so a small proposition. So f from x to y a function, x and y are topological spaces. But then the following are equivalent. So first, f is continuous. So this is a global. Continuous is a global always, okay, if you don't say anything. F is continuous. 2i. For every closed subset, for every closed subset, how is it called? A of x doesn't, so that is probably the book. For every closed subset A of x, the pre one has, so the condition is that f of the closure of A is contained in the closure of f of A. Okay, so this is a condition here. That is sometimes useful. F of the closure of A is contained in the closure of A. Continuous means that's for every, sorry, makes no sense, no? For every subset A of X, F of the closure of A, if it's closed, A, okay? So for every subset, F of the closure of A contained in F of. So this is intuitively clear why. This means if we are in the closure of A, we are close to A. Now that's what it says, okay? And continuity means points which are close remain close, but whatever close means, okay? So if F, if we have a point in the closure of A, the image is in the closure of F of A. So this is continuity, okay? It's sort of, and second one, third one, pre-images of closed sets are closed. So continuity means pre-images of open sets are open, and now I write pre-images of closed sets are closed. Okay, so proof, I will prove something here. So proof. So let's start, what is the most interesting? Well, let's start with I implies 2i. So I write this way, no? We prove this. I implies 2i. So f is continuous, and now, so what we need, so let x be in the closure of a. We have to prove this, that f of the closure of a is contained in the closure of f of a. So let x be in the closure of a. Then we have to prove that f of x is in the closure of f of a, no? So what means closure? So let v or whatever let v be always a neighborhood of f of x. But f is continuous. F continuous implies that f minus 1 of v is the neighborhood of x. Pre-image of open sets are open. F minus 1 of a, f minus 1 of v is the neighborhood is a neighborhood of x. But x is in the closure of A. So this implies that then f minus 1 of V intersection A, what means in the closure, every neighborhood intersects. Okay, so this is non-empty. And then f of f minus 1 of V intersection A is non-empty. So if this is non-empty, then if you apply F, it remains non-empty, of course. And this is contained in V intersection. So this F of F minus 1 of V is contained in V, no? And F of A is F of A. So intersection F of A. So what F of intersection is contained. It's contained. Okay. So this is okay. So this means this is non-empty. And what does that mean? That means f of x is in the closure of f of a. So this is not very interesting. We use definitions, only definitions, okay, in this one. We use the definitions. More interesting is this one. 2i implies 3i. So, what we have to prove? What is... So, we take an open set A of X. What do we have to prove? We have to prove 3i. 3i means pre-images of closed sets are closed, okay? So we take a closed set in Y, so which is called B. Let B be closed in Y. And we have to prove the pre-image is closed in X. So the pre-image is A, I call A, so this is F minus 1 of B. the pre-image. We have to prove A is closed, okay? So F of A, of course, is then contained in B. Let X be, so we take any point in A, in the closure of A. We want to prove that A is closed, no? Right? Pre-image of closed sets are closed. So we take a point in the closure of A. Then F of X is contained where? In F of the closure of A, okay? But now we have our condition. What does it say? F of the closure is contained in, what does it say? In the closure of F of A, okay? That's our condition. And this, where is it contained? F of, closure of F of B. Is this F of A is contained in B, okay? So contained in B. But B, what is B? B is closed. Okay. So X is in the pre-image of B. F of X is in B. So X is in F minus 1 of B. What do we want to prove? I got less. F minus 1 of B. What is F minus 1 of B? A. So what we see here is strange. If X is in the closure of A, then X is in A, right? We start with the closure of A and we end in A. So this means A is equal to its closure, okay? So this means that X is equal to its closure. Well, this implies. What does it imply? This implies that A closure is equal to A, and this means A is closed. The pre-image of closed sets are closed. Okay. And then the third one is, I will not prove, because it's, we can immediately prove the equivalence if you want, okay? Because here we don't need anything. What is interesting is this in the middle. But this is equivalent to I, without 2i, we don't need 2i here. And this means, you take complements, just complements, okay? Take complements, take complements. I will not write the details here, take complements. To pass from open set to closed and vice versa, okay? To pass from open sets to closed ones, to closed sets, and vice versa. From closed sets to open sets. So this is boring. But there's an interesting point, instead of proving this, so there's another definition, which in the book you find in some exercises. We will see some exercises. A map is open, so f from x to y, a map, a function. Function and map is the same. It's open, it's an open map, or an open map. So, function and open map, okay, a map is an open map, is open. Here, use function, but this is now map. If images of open sets are open, okay? well, I shouldn't use the part of the blackboard. So the identity from the reals to the reals with the lower limit is not continuous, but it's open, of course, because an open set in the reals, applying the identity, is open in RL. So it's not continuous, but it's open. F is closed. So this is open. F is closed if images of closed sets are closed. So here we have open and closed. It's different than this one. For continuity, it's equivalent. Pre-image of open sets are open. Pre-image of closed sets are. This is the same, equivalent. For images, it's not equivalent. Because images don't behave so well as pre-images, OK? So in general, we will see example. In general, open map. An open map and closed map are not equivalent, okay? A map may be open and not closed. A map may be closed and not open, okay? Open and closed are not equivalent. For pre-images, everything is easy. But for images, open and closed, images don't behave well with respect to complements. That's the point, right? Pre-images, if you have disjoint sets, they remain disjoint. If you apply disjoint sets, they may be highly non-disjoint, okay? So that's the whole point. But it's interesting. In general, open and closed are not equivalent for maps, for functions, or maps. Function and map is the same. We will see examples. And we use this also, open and closed map. But more important is continuous, OK? OK, so this is. What is the next? What is a homeomorphism? OK. So this is an interesting point also, definition. Homeomorphism. A homeomorphism F from X to Y is, sorry, a homeomorphism is a bijective continuous map that's not sufficient for us, okay? Because we have this example. We have bijective continuous, but the inverse map is not continuous. That we don't want for homeomorphism. So is a bijective continuous map such that the inverse map, let me write here F, to use the notation F from X to Y is a bijective continuous map, F from X to Y, such that the inverse map, F minus 1, we write F minus 1 for the inverse map, okay? Such that the inverse map well, I'm not so sure what is the best with these blackboards. That's the point. It's also continuous, such that the inverse map is also continuous. And here we have this example that this is not automatic. Such that a continuous such that the inverse map, and we write F minus 1 also for this. This is pre-image sometimes. Sometimes it's the inverse map. It's the inverse map. F minus 1 to Y to X is also continuous. point. So that's a homeomorphism. And the basic problem of topology, the fundamental problem of topology, is a homeomorphism problem. So we have basic problem of topology, fundamental problem. So I like to emphasize this, fundamental problem of topology. And this is the homeomorphism problem. This is a homeomorphism problem, the homeomorphism problem. What does it say? By the way, if we have groups of vector spaces or algebraic objects, and we have a bijection, which is a homeomorphism also, okay, or linear in linear algebra, then the inverse map automatically is also linear. Okay? So there's a difference between algebra and topology. Okay? In algebra, for a bijection, which is a linear, let's say, vector spaces, then the inverse map automatically is also, okay, so it's an isomorphism. In topology, the inverse map is not automatically continuous, okay? Homeomorphism, so this is a homeomorphism problem. Given two spaces, X and Y, two topological spaces, of course. Here, spaces are always given two topological, are always topological spaces, okay? X and Y decide whether X and Y are homeomorphic or not homeomorphic. Are homeomorphic? Or not? As a decision problem. Okay? So given two spaces, for any space you can ask it, and then you ask, well, are they homeomorphic? Homeomorphic means it's more or less the same space, okay, with another notation. They're not equal, but this is a different presentation of the same space, okay? We give different names. So there are two points here. So, if they are homeomorphic, maybe we can construct a homeomorphism, okay? If you suppose they are homeomorphic, then there are many examples in algebra, in analysis, in the book also, that I don't do, okay? If you suppose they are homeomorphic, then maybe, then we should construct a homeomorphism. Not always works, but then we should be, then construct a homeomorphism. If they are homeomorphic, construct a homeomorphism. If they are not homeomorphic, we have to distinguish. And how to do that? If you suppose they are not homeomorphic, so what to do? We cannot consider all maps, all bijective continuous maps. That's impossible if spaces are compact. So then we want to find a property, a topological property, which distinguishes between them, okay? That's the way how to do that. Then we want to find, so here constructive, here we have to find a property. Then we want to find, this is not a definition, a topological property which distinguishes the two spaces. So I give an example. And this is general topology, okay? Topological property. So this is general topology, what we are doing in general topology. A topological property which distinguishes, I will give an example immediately, which distinguishes the two spaces in general topology. Or we want to, and then there's algebraic topology, and there we want to find an algebraic invariant which distinguishes, okay? Or, well, I have to pass to the other side. So you have this, and now we continue. Maybe it's difficult to follow, but with this blackboard, it's very convenient if you are here, but maybe at home, it's not so convenient. I don't know. So I read again. If they are not homeomorphic, then we want to find a topological property which distinguishes, and this is in general topology, or an algebraic invariant which distinguishes. Or an algebraic invariant. These are just names. It's not a definition. Or an algebraic invariant which distinguishes the two spaces. And this is algebraic topology, okay? In algebraic topology. That we will do in the second term. We do general topology, okay? In the second term, there's algebraic topology, fundamental group homology, cohomology, whatever. I mean, this goes on and on. In algebraic topology. So here we have algebraic topology, and there we have general topology. Example. And this is now the first, it's nice. I like this. As I said, the lower limit is one of the main examples, okay, in the book. So R standard. So if I write this, it's standard topology, okay? And RL, lower limit. Topology, homeomorphic? Stupid question, maybe. But, well, for any two spaces, you can ask it, okay? So let's take the reals and the lower limit. Yeah, you suppose, no, maybe they're not. But then you have to find something, okay? A topological property. We don't have many examples, and I introduce no example. Yeah, that comes later, okay? But then we have to prove something. Maybe, yes, you are right. Maybe you prove this is connected, whatever that is, and this is not connected. This is a topological property. If they are homeomorphic, this is connected, if and only if this is connected, okay? Connectedness is okay, yes, right. But then we have to prove that this is connected, right? And that's not completely trivial. There's something much easier, because we are talking about basis, okay? So definition. And this is from the fourth chapter. But it's a very good point here for me. I like it. A topological space X is, and now we have the word second countable. A topological space is second countable if it has a countable basis. So this is a topological property, countable basis, okay? What I didn't define, but this is a topological property. The only other one which we know, which one is that? We have one already. Very general one, Hausdorff. T2, Hausdorff. Now that's a topological property, okay? And this is a topological property. And now an exercise, but important exercise. So are the reals, what do you say? Are they second countable? Do they have a countable basis? The reals, the standard? Yes, exactly. R standard has a countable basis. They have a countable basis. It has a countable basis. Which one? Rational intervals, okay? So AB. So AB in Q, A is smaller than B. So all rational intervals. This is the basis for R. We don't need all intervals. The rationals are dense, they're closures, everything. So it's a basis. It's a countable basis. It's a countable basis. For R, for the standard R. That, well, the proof, of course, here is analysis. Now, you know, here are the reals. I make a picture. So we take what I call the basis recognition theorem, okay? So what it means, we take an open set, okay? We take a point. No, what do you want to want? It's a basis, yeah. We take an open set, okay? Open sets, we cannot describe explicitly, okay? Basis, yes, but open sets, not. So we take an open set, we take a point, but that means we have, by the definition of the standard, by intervals. So we find an interval here, which contains the point, is contained in the open set, right? But this are a real interval, okay? But now, we know that Q is dense. That's the word. The closure is. So this is in R, okay? This point is in the reals, no? But now, in this interval, open interval, we find, what do we find? We find a rational point, okay? In each interval, we have rationals. So now we can Q, and here also, a point which is in the rational. So we find a point. And that means, given this point, given the open set, given any point, we find one of these rational intervals, which contains the point, is contained, okay? And then the basis recognition theorem says, this is the basis, okay? Yeah, exactly. And then there is a proposition, and this is nice, RL does not have a countable basis. This is an exercise also, okay? An example, exercise, proposition, whatever, so proof. RL does not have a countable, R has a countable basis, but RL does not have a countable basis. So we take any basis. Let B be any basis of RL, of the lower limit topology. Take any basis. We have to prove B is not countable. There's no countable basis. So, for X, let X be in any point in the reals. Then X is contained in, so what are we? We have the lower limit. So So x is contained in x, x plus 1. And this is open in the lower limit. That's a basis element even. So the open in the lower limit. In the lower limit. This is open in the lower limit. But what means basis? This is a basis. That means given an open set, given a point, there's a basis element which contains the point is contained in the open set. Okay? So this implies there exists, so there exists this implies there is Bx in B. But we find the basis element such that x is in Bx is contained in our open set, which is x, x plus 1. So this is a crucial point of the whole proof. For each x, x is contained here, and then we find Bx, okay? So now we have a function phi from R to B. So x, for each x, you choose bx. It's this property, okay? Choose. For each x, you choose a bx, okay? Axiom of choice. Looks like axiom of choice. Then phi is injective. This is the injective function. If it's injective, this is not countable. So if it's injective, this is not countable. Okay? That's the proof. So phi is injective. Take two points, x and y in R. So R, this is a set. Okay? RL. But then I write R. If I take the set. Suppose x is smaller than y. Take two points, two different points in the reals, then x, so I write this condition, x is in bx contained in x, x plus 1, and y is in by contained in y, y plus 1. By construction, now this is the choice, our choice. So what we have, x is smaller than y. So x is not here, x is smaller than y, okay? So x is not here. So x is not here. It's not in by. But x is in bx, of course, okay? But x is in bx. So it's not in by, but it's in bx. So they are different. Bx is different from by. So this implies bx is different from by. That means that phi is injective. But r is not countable. And this implies, of course, then the image b. Well, I don't know the image. I mean, it's injective, so the image of R here is not countable. So B is not countable. Countable. And that's the end of the proof. Okay. That's the most interesting part of the course so far, this second countable, R, RL, homeomorphism, no homeomorphism, okay? This is an interesting example. This is an interesting example, typical for general topology. a little bit different from analysis. No, in analysis you have standard examples. No, that's also not true. I mean, in analysis there are complicated spaces. No, you have topologies on function spaces. No, various topologies. So this is not so standard then, okay? But if you take R2 standard analysis, then I mean it's easy, no closures and so on and so on. So this is a standard. This is not so standard. RL, but interesting. So what is the next one? Well, I come back to this. Now we do something else, which is also an interesting point. We defined the product topology for two spaces, and now we generalize for infinitely many spaces, okay? So the product topology again. We come back to this second countable. This is an important point, okay? Second countable is an important point. And equally interesting is first, there will be also first countable, okay? And that's also interesting. This is second countable, first countable. We will see, maybe tomorrow. So what? The product topology. Again, but more general now. So we have taken arbitrary product now. So we have a product. This is a pi capital of x alpha, alpha in J. I use the notation of the book, of course. So this is a product, Cartesian product of topological spaces X alpha. These are all topological spaces. And we take the Cartesian product. Cartesian, no, it's, I will not define this. Cartesian product of topological spaces alpha, and J is an index set, okay? J is an index set. And the point, of course, if you have two or three, then we have a topology, okay? But now, maybe infinite, and that's the interesting point. This makes a difference, okay? J is an index set, which may be infinite, maybe infinite. And then it's not so clear, maybe infinite. That is a interesting point again. How to define the topology then? Of course, we want a topology here now, okay? These are topological spaces, now we want on the product the topology. This is not an exercise only, okay? You say infinite products, yeah, they are in mathematics important infinite products, of course. So how to define? It's not so clear, okay, at first sight. For two spaces, it was easy. However, for infinitely many, if you have infinitely many, for three, it's okay by induction, okay? But for infinitely many, how to define? It's not clear. So we introduce a notation. So let pi, now this is a small pi, for an index, for alpha in J, let, we take an index, pi alpha, we take the projection onto the, so from product, I'm sorry, I should, introduce already here the way how we want to write for elements, okay? So what is this? So we write it this way, we take x alpha, alpha in J, we write this way, okay? This looks like a upel, n upel, but it may be infinite, no? Where x alpha is in x alpha capital. Sorry. So that's how we want to write elements, okay? Here. Formally, these are functions from index set into the union of x, but this is too formal, okay? So I will not use this definition. So we write this way. So here, now I come back to this point. X alpha, alpha and j, have too many alphas, no? So we fix, okay, because here is alpha. So beta in J, and then, sorry, pi beta, no? From the product X alpha, alpha in J, to X beta. And what is this? The B the projection onto the beta coordinate, okay, B the projection. That's a projection onto the beta coordinate. So, using our notation, what does it mean? Using our notation, this means that pi beta, this is a small pi. This is a capital pi. Pi beta of x alpha, alpha in j. So our point, we want to write in this way. Okay, this is a point. X alpha, alpha in j. And pi beta, what is it? X beta. That's easy, no? X beta. That's the beta coordinate of this, okay? Which is x beta. So these are the projections. So this is notation, okay? And of course, what we want is that these projections, we want to define a topology here, okay, on this. And of course, a good topology, okay, a reasonable. And of course, we want that these are the only maps which we see, okay? They are the projections, and they should be continuous. We want that are continuous, no? So I pass to the other end of the blackboard. I don't know what is better. Maybe I go back in this direction, but it's not so easy because I don't know where to start to write. It's easier to go. Otherwise, I don't know where I should. So we want all projections pi beta to be continuous. That we want. But there are some stupid topologies, of course. We may take the discrete topology, which is not interesting, okay? Then all are continuous. The discrete one, but that's not a good choice. What does it mean? So this means that if you take an open set in X beta, then the preimage should be open in the product, okay? So we call S, that's subbasis. Beta. So this is beta, S beta. What we call? We take the preimage pi beta minus 1 of U beta. We take preimages of open sets, U beta open in X beta, okay? U beta open in X beta. Pre-images of open sets. Then Sorry, I write this way. Then S beta should consist of open sets. Should consist. They have to be open. Should consist of open sets, of course. We don't still don't have a topology. Consists of open sets. For all beta in the index. No, we want all projections to be continuous. So we want all these to be continuous, no? So we take the union. S. And also should consist of open set and also S, which is a union, S beta. Beta in J. This and also should consist of open sets, no? Now what? The game is the following. So this might be already a topology, okay? Yeah. Then we say, well, that's a good topology, probably, okay? This is a good topology, but it is not a topology. If it's not a topology, then the next choice is basis of a topology. Well, if you think we will see, or if you think a minute, it's not a basis, okay? So if it's not a basis, then subbasis. And subbasis, we have no condition on this, okay? So S is a subbasis. This is a subbasis. That's why S is a subbasis for topology on the product X alpha, alpha in J. This is a subbasis for a topology. Well, sometimes it might be even a basis, okay? But it depends on the spaces. If they are very trivial spaces, then... But in general, it's a subbasis for topology on the product, which generates, by definition, the product topology. That's the product topology, which generates. And this is the product topology. So here we have the product topology. This is called product topology. That's the definition already, which generates the product. So this is the definition of the product topology, okay? So I mean, this is the definition of the product topology. I emphasize this. So this is a definition for one definition. Maybe this definition for us of the product topology. So now we defined it. Maybe without this parenthesis. This is a definition of the product topology. This is a subbasis, which defines the product topology. So what we can immediately remark is the product, so the product topology so this is a very conceptual definition now, characterization now. So the product topology is the finest or coarsest topology such that all projections are continuous. Is the coarsest, no? The strange word. The smallest. What does it use? Which word? Coarsest, yeah, right, okay. That's the word. The smallest. So the product topology is the coarsest. Coarsest means smallest. But we don't use this word smallest, no, but it's the coarsest topology on this product, X alpha, alpha in J, such that all projections are continuous. If all projections are continuous, this has to consist of open sets. Okay? And then we pass through bases, open sets also, and then we pass through the topology. It's on, it's such that all projections pi, beta, or alpha, pi, beta, I called them beta, no? Before, are continuous. This is the coarsest topology. This is a nice conceptual characterization of the product topology. It's the coarsest topology such that all projections are continuous, okay? The finest topology is a discrete one, right? But that's not interesting. The coarsest is interesting. The indiscrete doesn't work in general, okay? Nothing is continuous. So we take the minimum. And now I want to describe a basis for the topology. And then the subbasis. Sorry. And then the a basis. Okay. We have a subbasis. So let me write that. So what is pi beta minus 1 of u? I wrote before. Where is it? There. Pi beta minus 1 of u beta. What is this? What is this? That's a product, okay? This says something, the beta coordinate should be in u beta. And the other coordinates are not important, okay? So this is a product of V alpha, alpha and J, such that V alpha is equal to X alpha if alpha is different from beta. Then we have no condition. And V alpha is equal to U alpha. U alpha is beta, okay? If alpha is equal to beta. So this is U beta. That's a somewhat stupid way, but that's what it is, okay? This says, the beta coordinate of a point here is in u beta. And the other coordinates are arbitrary. That's what it is. Okay? So now we, how do we pass to a basis? Now I want to describe a basis. Because we want to work with a basis, not with a subbasis. Basis is more convenient. So I will write a basis. So in general, we know how to pass from C to a basis, B, subbasis, basis. What do we do? Finite intersections. That's the way how we pass from a subbasis to a basis. Taking finite, so we take a finite intersection, okay? So what are these? Are these, no? So I use the notation pi beta minus 1. So we take a finite intersection. So B is equal to. I take finitely many of these. So pi beta 1 minus 1 of u beta 1. Intersection, finite intersection, pi beta whatever, n, what is it called? N, yeah, it doesn't matter. I cannot read in the book. I shouldn't change from the book. Yeah, n, it's called n. Minus 1 of u beta n. Where, what? Do beta I are open in X beta I. And we can assume also that beta 1, beta n, we can assume that they are all different. If they are all equal, we can, maybe they are all equal, the indices. Then we have, we can make it shorter, okay? One. So we can assume, so beta 1, beta n are indices. And we can assume all different, that they are all different. They are all different. If you have two equal indices here, the first two, then p beta minus 1 of u beta 1 and p beta 1 minus 1 of u beta 1 prime is p pi beta minus 1 of the intersection of these two, okay? So we can make it shorter. Okay, so we can assume if we want, and we want that the indices here are all different, okay? If they're not different, then we can simplify. So what is this equal to what? So, these are products. And now, what have we have? We have conditions on n coordinates, okay? Conditions. Here we have on one coordinate, now on n coordinates, okay? So we take products. U alpha. I'm trying to use the notation of the book, okay? So U alpha always. U alpha, alpha and j, such that this stuff here. These are products such that u alpha is equal to x alpha if we don't have one of these indices, we have no condition. We have a condition only for these indices. So this is, says that it, the beta one first coordinate should be here. And so on. But for the other indices, we have no condition. So this means it's F alpha, except for finitely many indices, beta 1, beta n, except for finitely many indices, beta 1, beta n in J, and n is in n also, okay? We don't know how many we take, okay? N in n. And of course, u alpha open, in any case, u alpha is open in u alpha is open in x alpha. Here it's clear it's x alpha, but also for this finitely many. So this is B. So we will use this description. We take products of open sets where u alpha is equal to the whole, except for finitely many indices. And these are these beta 1, beta n, okay? So B is the basis which generates the product topology. B is the basis. It generates product topology. So this is the basis. It generates a topology. the sub-basis, and now we have a basis, and we work with the basis in general, not with the sub-basis. And now you say, well, there might be something easier, no? This is an interesting point. So we take just products of open sets. Okay, somebody says, let's just take products of open sets. And not this condition here, okay? U alpha, so check B prime. B prime. So now I define a little bit different. So I take just products. Product U alpha, alpha and J, where U alpha is open in X alpha. Also here, U alpha is, of course, open in X alpha, okay? But we have this condition here, no? And now we forget about this condition. Also, so the point is also, B is a basis. For a topology, this is the basis, that's easy to see. For a topology, also this B prime is the basis for a topology on the product X alpha, alpha and J. Also this is the basis. But this is in general a different topology, which generates, by definition, the box topology. This is called box topology. This is a box. These are also boxes, but very special boxes. Infinite boxes. Here we can take everything. It's a basis for a topology on the X, which generates, and that's the definition of the box topology. So this is the definition of the box topology. And this seems to be easier, no, than that. It looks easier. The definition is shorter. However, what we will see is that, in general, the product topology has good properties. Okay, many good properties. The box topology, everything which can go wrong goes wrong, has very bad properties. Okay, so this is not a good topology. The product topology is a good topology. If you have the box topology, everything goes wrong. Almost everything goes wrong. For the box topology, we will see examples of this, okay? But the box but for us also the box topology is interesting as an example. We like in general topology, we like also complicated strange spaces, not just the standard spaces R, R2, Rn, okay? And here we have another one, this box topology, okay? This is the more standard, okay? But it was not clear at the beginning what is a good definition. One has to work, okay, on properties. But the point is that this is has very good properties, okay? And this, almost everything goes wrong, which can go wrong. There are too many open sets. So now we have the definition of the product topology. Where is it? It's the basis which runs the product topology, and we have the box topology. And we have to work with both. We want to consider both. So this is the definition. So I make a last a last proposition, okay, for today. I have 1 minute, but I started late, 3-4 minutes now, so I will do this. And as always, because in university we start at 15 always, okay, at 4:15, and we finish at 45, okay. Here we start at 0:00 and we finish at 30, but sometimes I forget that. So I should finish at 30, no? But I'm always thinking 45. Anyway, 3 minutes, okay? So the last proposition. Where are we? Here, on this blackboard. So proposition. Last one for today. 3 minutes. Let f function from A to a product x alpha, alpha and j, be given by the equation, be given by f of alpha. So we have the coordinate functions. So these are called f alpha of f of a, sorry. Alpha is an index, okay? F, so we have a. F of a is f alpha of a, alpha in j. So these are the coordinates, okay? So what is f alpha? F alpha, of course, is f and then the projection, no? So we introduce some notation just. With S alpha is F and then P alpha, the pi alpha. That's what it is, no? What, how do you call this? The alpha coordinate function, okay? That's how you may call it. The alpha, alpha's coordinate. Coordinate function of F. That's what it is. But this is the definition of F alpha, okay? So we write this in this way, okay? Then, now I'm finished here. So I will write here, okay. Maybe that's even that's better to go in this way than back, but I'm not sure. Depends how much you see. Yeah, probably it's better to go back. But I don't know where to start now. Now it's no problem. Oh, sorry. Then. Well, then. F is continuous. Ah, what topology? Suppose we have the product topology, okay? Suppose product X alpha, alpha and J has a product topology. Then, F is continuous. If and only if all F alpha are continuous, alpha and j. So for all alpha and j. So F is continuous if all coordinate functions are continuous. This is very reasonable, okay? So the proof. Then F is continuous, all F alpha. One direction is easy. Which one? F is this one. If F is, so this one is immediate. If F is continuous, so what is F? F is F and then the projection onto the alpha's coordinate, okay? That's what F is. And now a composition of continuous maps is continuous. Okay, so F is continuous. So this is continuous. Now this is continuous. And now I write a composition of continuous maps is continuous. Every composition of continuous maps is continuous. I abbreviate that, continuous, no? A composition of continuous maps is that's a trivial exercise, okay? Pre-image of open sets are what? Okay, thanks. Yes, yes, F alpha. So a composition of continuous maps is continuous, so F alpha is continuous, okay? That's trivial, no? If pre-image under this of an open set, you first take pre-image under this and then under this. If both are continuous, it's open, open in two steps. So that's trivial. And then the other direction. Maybe it is better to go back. I'm not so sure. Because it depends how much you see from the blackboard. Yeah, you see this part, right? Up to here you can see. So if I pass to the other side, then you don't see this, no? So probably it's better to go back. I don't know. I will try that, okay? Because now I see. Well, depends. You don't see too much, no? It goes up to this point here. It's not so clear. I'm not sure. Well, now we have the other direction. What is it? This one. So all now all F alpha continues. And now we can work with the subbasis. We don't work with the subbasis very often, but here's one point, okay? So F is continuous if all pre-images of a subbasis of this, let's take the subbasis which we have. The subbasis S, what was S? That's the union S alpha, no? Alpha and J. If all pre-images of the subbasis S alpha are open, we can restrict to elements of a subbasis. So what? So let a typical element here. What is it? Is P alpha minus pi alpha minus one of U alpha. Now that's a typical element of S alpha. No, this one. So this is the typical element of S alpha, right? That's what we wrote before. And now it takes a pre-image. So what? So we take the pre-image. So F minus 1 of pi alpha minus 1 of U alpha. So what is this? So it's a pre-image. First pi alpha, then F minus 1 of U alpha. But what is this? This is F alpha, right? So this is F alpha minus 1 of U alpha. But F alpha is continuous, no? So this is open. It's open. This is open since F alpha is continuous. And this implies that F is continuous. Okay, so this implies, all this implies F continuous. So it's convenient to work with the subbasis, okay? Okay, so tomorrow we go on a little bit with this. And then the last point in the first chapter, we have also discussed. This is an interesting point, product and box topology. Okay, they are important examples. And we will see tomorrow some interesting point here. It gets more and more interesting, this second chapter. Okay, there are three chapters, basically. There's four chapters. The first one is this, what we are doing. The second one is connected spaces and path connected and whatever. Compact, there's a lot of compactness, okay? Limit point compact, sequentially compact, compact, and so on and so on. And then the last chapter is normal regular spaces and something like that. These are the 4 points. The first part is topology, basis, subbasis, continuity, basis concepts, okay? Some interesting examples already. Product topology. The second will continue. Oh, but you have the book. You should have the book. Tomorrow I will give. I will choose some exercises. I gave some exercises last week. Tomorrow I give exercises from the book, which I will not write because then it's too long. Okay. I give the pages of the book and the exercises tomorrow, and then you have 1 week to think about exercises, and then we discuss. One typical exercise already is that RL is not second countable. Okay, that's a proposition, but that's a nice exercise. Easy, but interesting. So we see tomorrow at 4, okay? So for today is finished, and then we go on a little bit with this topology tomorrow.